mitogens, which cause mitosis of cells and increase the number and size of cells both. So there is atypical ductal hyperplasia, and if it further progresses due to some carcinogenic stimuli, then we progress to ductal carcinoma in situ. And what's the difference between ADH and DCIS? It's the rule of two. More than two ducts involved, so here you can see three ducts involved. More than two ducts involved, or more than 2 millimeter in diameter, more than two. Up to two ducts, less than 2 millimeter, it is called atypical ductal hyperplasia, ADH. More than two ducts, more than two lobules, it is called 2 millimeter DCIS. And when the basement membrane breaks, it becomes invasive ductal carcinoma, IDC. Okay. Similarly, we can have proliferation of the lobules, and this will lead to atypical lobular hyperplasia, and this may progress to lobular carcinoma in situ, and which becomes malignant in the form of invasive lobular carcinoma. So this is how it will progress: invasive ductal carcinoma, invasive lobular carcinoma. Okay. So this is the natural history of EDLU progressing to hyperplasia, then dysplasia, and then in situ carcinoma, then invasive carcinoma. So high risk lesions can be defined as those which carry a high risk for developing into breast carcinoma if left alone, untreated. It is also defined as a lesion which on core biopsy has a high chance of showing cancer on excision, i.e. high risk of getting upgraded. So let us understand what do you mean. We took a biopsy, and biopsy shows a benign lesion. Okay. But when we excise this lesion, we will find a cancer. It's called upgradation. The diagnosis or the proliferation has got upgraded to cancer. Was benign biopsy, but when we excise the whole lesion, it got upgraded to cancer. In the core biopsy, the pathologist reported some proliferative breast disease. There is a benign epithelial and mesenchymal proliferation, fibroepithelial lesion, benign fibroepithelial lesion. That's the usual term this day. But when you excised, you found there is a focus of cancer. So these lesions are also called high risk lesions. Okay. And we'll see which are these lesions which get upgraded. On core biopsy is benign, but final excision shows upgrading. So naturally, if you know which lesion has high chance of upgraded to getting cancer, we will try to remove it fully. Okay. Two definitions. And various growth factors, risk factors work on the ductolobular tissue to stimulate the cells from hyperplasia to neoplasia. Estrogen is a stimulus, is perhaps the most important risk factor, because breast cancer is predominantly a disease of ladies. So estrogen is present as a female hormone. Men have 100th chance of getting breast cancer compared to ladies. Men have 1/100 chance of getting breast cancer. So obviously, there's marked difference in the level of hormone estrogen. So estrogen is the root cause for breast cancer. It has been found that if young girls undergo bilateral ovarian removal for some reason, like ectopic or some type of ovarian abscess or something, or during some accident, these young girls, after oophorectomy in early age, become immune to breast cancer. They do not develop breast cancer at all. That proves the point that estrogen is the root cause of breast cancer formation. And that's why anti-estrogen drugs can reduce the risk of breast cancer. That point also goes in favor of estrogen as the triggering factor or the risk factor. Parity is associated with breast cancer early, first maybe around 20 to 22, and breastfeeding for about 1.5 to 2 years seems protective. Again, it has something to do with the hormone levels. Number of genetic conditions, genetic factors, mutations, and familial relationship, even without known genetic factors, also increase the risk. So, term familial is used where no known genetic mutation is found. Only family history is present, but on genetic testing of their blood lymphocytes, no known genetic mutation is observed. Then the word familial will be used. Family history alone is a risk factor in about 30%. If family history is present, say mother or sister had breast cancer, first degree blood relative, then that lady has 30% chance of developing breast cancer in her lifetime. Lifetime means till age 70. Lifetime means till age 70. Okay. So there's a difference in some exams. You know, they may ask, what's the difference between familial and genetic factors? So genetic is, you do genetic testing and you find that BRCA1, BRCA2, P53, Gowden, you know, P10 gene, they're all mutated. Here, ATM gene. But in familial, no known genetic mutation is observed. And yet, family history is there. So that also confers high risk of developing. Childhood exposure to radiation in the chest area, in the upper chest area or head and neck area, if you offer radiotherapy for, say, Hodgkin's disease in childhood, the relative risk for cancer conversion is 6. So early childhood exposure to radiation increases the risk of breast cancer. Okay? In young girls who were living in Ukraine in the erstwhile USSR in 1986, I think, 1984, a Chernobyl disaster happened in Ukraine province, and there was a nuclear reactor which got burst, and a lot of radioactive material was released, and this led to increased chance of thyroid cancer and breast cancer. Then number of benign breast diseases. So today we'll be talking mostly of these benign breast diseases, which carry an increased risk of developing breast cancer. Intake of tobacco and alcohol again increase the risk of a lady developing breast cancer. So you should know about it, and when you are counseling a lady who carries higher risk, you should counsel them against the usage of tobacco. Fortunately, very few of our Indian mothers and sisters consume tobacco or alcohol. Obesity is certainly a risk factor for developing breast cancer, especially in the which group? Postmenopausal or premenopausal?
Premenopausal.
Premenopausal, okay. And physical activity. So sedentary lifestyle is a risk factor, and regular physical activity, 40 minutes to 60 minutes exercise daily, tends to protect breast cancer. So again, you can use this information in counseling a patient who has a high risk. Hormone replacement therapy, especially high dose estrogen therapy, given for 10 years at a stretch, continuously for 10 years, HRT, increases the risk about 20 times, 20%. So the hazard ratio of developing breast cancer was 1.2. 1.2 means 20% more increase of breast cancer in women who had used HRT for 10 years or more. Now, with this, there's a famous 1 million study in England. They took 1 million ladies who were taking HRT and studied that the risk was 20% increase. So based on that information, now gynecologists have become wiser, and they do not use HRT in the conventional high dose estrogen, number one. Number two, they do not use it continuously at a stretch. They give it for short periods, say 3 months, then hormone holiday for 3 months, then use. So this way, you tend to reduce the risk of breast cancer by continuous hormonal stimulation. And there are non-hormonal methods of controlling postmenopausal symptoms and syndromes. You can use them. reduce the chance of breast cancer. Mammographic density. So on mammogram, the breast ductal ovary tissue looks dense. Sometimes the density is graded as A, B, C, D. So C and D are carrying higher risk of developing breast cancer. And large mammary gland is also a risk factor for. Okay, so how can we ascertain a lady's risk, whether she has high risk or low risk? Number of mathematical or statistical models have been developed over the years. Gale is a gentleman. He is a medical doctor, MD, medicine, and then he fell in love with statistics. He's around 80 year old. The friend of Dr. Smail Jatoi, he texts about Dr. Gale, who works in National Cancer Institute in America, Bethesda, NIH, and he developed a statistical model based on certain criteria, and this is called Gale model. Then number of other models have also been developed over the years. In England, Dr. Cusick is a statistician in London, in Medical Research Council, and he developed this model called Tyrer-Cusick model, based on the data derived from International Breast Invasive Study. International Breast Invasive Study, they studied the risk of breast cancer in women who have high risk on the basis of Gale model, and they gave tamoxifen for 5 years and showed that the risk was reduced. So these ladies were studied for a long time, and Dr. Cusick had the opportunity of maintaining this data, and he then calculated a statistical model, which is called Tyrer-Cusick model. And this BRCA Pro model is another model. And so these models are used to evaluate a person's risk of developing breast cancer. Okay. So based on the intensity or severity of the risk, you can classify them into average risk. It is less than 15% lifetime risk. Lifetime means if the lady lives till age 70. That's average lifespan, it is estimated. So in the statistical terms, when we say lifetime risk, we mean that if lady lives till age 70, this is the risk. 15% will develop breast cancer. This is called average risk. And mind you, this is the American data. In America, lifetime risk is about 12%. A lady, average lady on the in the population who doesn't have any excessive risk, he has about 12 to 15%. So less than 15, average risk. 16 to 25, moderate risk. 25 to 50, high risk. And more than 50, old, very high risk. So how do you approach this patient? Suppose a patient is coming to your clinic. Her mother got breast cancer, so she really got upset. She got her mammogram done, and she has come to you and sitting in your clinic. So how will you approach her? Well, approach is start with the basic steps, detailed family history. Who in the family? How many members in the family? Whether they are first degree, mother, sister, mother, sister, mother's mother, father's mother, and father's sister. Father's mother and father's sister also carry some risk of genetic mutation and increased risk. You know, the BRCA gene is transmitted through both mother and father. So from the father's side, BRCA gene will have a history of breast cancer in father's mother or father's sister. Okay. And father may have prostate cancer or pancreatic cancer. We should record that history in detail. Usually it is said that if the family members, mother or sister, got cancer below the age of 50, it is said to have high genetic relationship. If it occurred in age 70 or 80, then it is probably sporadic cancer, not related to genetic mutation. Because if you are having the gene, abnormal gene, you will probably develop cancer by the age of 50. So below 50, cancers are considered thought to be related to familial or genetic inheritance. Now, history, whether in the childhood, the lady had any radiation therapy, especially for Hodgkin's disease. In Hodgkin's disease of the chest and neck nodes, they offer mental radiation, and childhood radiation in for Hodgkin's or other diseases may increase the risk 6 times. The relative risk is 6. Very high risk. Prior breast biopsy, whether biopsy showed fibroadenoma, still you have to carry that that carries a slightly increased risk than somebody who never had a biopsy. And certain pathological findings on that biopsy. So you ask, madam, did you ever have any lump removed or any biopsy done for your breast? He says yes. Then you find what was the report. And if the report was a typical ductal hyperplasia, lobular hyperplasia, or lobular carcinoma in situ, you get worried, and then you say, okay, this is a high risk lesion. Okay. History of breast biopsy and the finding of that biopsy should also be noted. Then you proceed with physical examination, you perform general examination, and then detailed clinical breast examination on both sides in sitting and in lying position, and 5 steps. Step 1, hand by the side, sitting. Step 2, hand raised above the head, and you are inspecting. So, seeing in sitting position, and then lady is requested to lie on her back on a hard bed or couch with a pillow under the shoulder blade and arm raised above the head. Arm raised above the head and pillow under the shoulder blade. And in this position, you palpate using different methods. We prefer dial of a clock method using pad of 3 fingers, 3 times palpation. We perform detailed physical examination. If you find some discrete lump or nipple retraction or bloody nipple discharge, bloody or serous discharge, then you arrange imaging these ladies. And if there is a strong family history, then it is better to arrange what?
MRI,
because they said that these genetic mutation carriers have BRCA gene is responsible for DNA repair. It is called DNA repair gene. So if the BRCA gene is mutated, then its ability to repair the DNA is lost. Okay. So if DNA is damaged by some radiation exposure or some other carcinogen, then it will not repair. Okay. So, DNA repair gene is abnormal in BRCA1, BRCA2 mutation, and therefore, you should arrange preferably a MRI. If the previous biopsy showed lobular carcinoma, again lobular lesion, or lobular hyperplasia, again, you should prefer to do MRI. Mammogram, being a radiation, being an X-ray, carries a slightly increased risk of risk increasement, increase, because it's a it's a type of ionizing radiation. So some experts advise only MRI, and others say, okay, MRI once a year and mammogram once a year. Current generation digital mammogram emit very low dose radiation, and perhaps it is not harmful if it is done only once in a year. And then you arrange biopsy of any suspicious Girard's 4 or 5 lesion. Based on all this finding, then you request your genetic counselor to please offer detailed genetic counseling. And if based on that counseling, the counselor decides that she has a high risk of developing cancer, then she will offer genetic testing either by taking saliva and then separating the mucosal cells, and DNA from those cells is extracted. Then mutation of common genes like BRCA1, BRCA2, P53, ATM, CLDN10, etc. are evaluated. Alternatively, you can collect about blood and then isolate lymphocytes from that blood, and from the lymphocytes separate the DNA, and DNA is then used for evaluating the genetic. So either blood cell from lymphocytes or from saliva, buccal mucosal cells testing. And if the testing shows some genetic mutation, then you have to offer some long-term surveillance and the strategy for prevention if the risk is thought to be high. So long-term surveillance of a patient is also a method of assessing a patient's risk. How? Today you do MRI or mammogram and you find it is normal. Okay, it's called Birads 2, say, or Birads 1. 5 years later, you are doing yearly mammogram and MRI. You find that now some lesion, suspicious lesion has appeared, some architecture distortion, some microcalcification. So long-term surveillance is also a method, in fact, a very sensitive method of evaluating a lady's risk. So it is not one-off process. It's not just one consultation in the clinic. It is a continued process, continuing. It's a continuum like that. And you continue it for years. Because as the years pass by, the risk of ladies tends to increase. Because cancer by and large is a disease of aging. Okay. So as the cells age, their repair mechanism gets damaged. And if they are exposed to some carcinogen, the long term, they then become malignant. So continue the surveillance till about 5 or 70. After 70, most studies do not recommend very intensive surveillance because by the time if the lady had genetic risk, she would have developed cancer by this age. If she has not yet developed cancer by age 70, it is unlikely that she will now develop it. And you may just advise her self-breast examination. And if she finds anything abnormal, then you can call her for appropriate management. Now, a number of authors have studied the risk of developing breast cancer among women who have some kind of benign breast disease. And the most famous study was conducted by Dr. William DuPont and David Page. William DuPont and David Page in America, and he published this classical treatise in New England Journal of Medicine, January 1985, page number 146. And the title was The Risk of Developing Breast Cancer, Risk of Breast Cancer in Women with Proliferative Breast Disease. So you should all read this paper. I will send a PDF later on, email, and you can all enjoy this classic treatise in breast diseases, like papers of Veronese, Bernard Fisher. So again, this paper of DuPont and Page is very famous. And this was the first paper where they classified the benign breast disease into three categories: non-proliferative, proliferative without atypia, and proliferative with atypia. Non-proliferative and proliferative without atypia and proliferative with it. Okay, three categories were given, and we'll come to the details later. Another very informative paper is from the Mayo Clinic, Dr. Lynn Hartman and her group have published extensively. They have the 25 years follow-up of about 13,000 patients. Initially, they had 9,000, and now they have, I think, about 13,000 patients who had their biopsy for benign disease. And these ladies have been kept on long-term follow-up as long as 25 years. And recently, they published their experience in 2015. This is an older paper. So, but this gives the information about the Mayo Clinic experience of long-term follow-up of benign breast disease. And again, from the same Mayo Clinic, Dr. Emmy Dignam, she also works, she is a breast surgeon in Dr. Hartman's group, Dignam, D-E-G-N-I-M, Dignam et al, Emmy is the first name. And we had the opportunity of listening to her and learning from her during her visit to Asian Society of Mastology meeting held in Maldives in Malé in 2018, October. Emmy Dignam, very famous breast surgeon, working in Mayo Clinic. And she has done a lot of work on risk reduction and risk evaluation. So you can classify benign breast disease into four categories. Low risk. Low risk means relative risk is 1.3 or less. And these lesions are called non-proliferative, according to DuPont and Page, William DuPont and David Page. And this includes fibroadenoma, cyst, usual ductal hyperplasia. What is usual ductal hyperplasia? Can somebody define what is usual ductal hyperplasia?
Increase of number of layers in the duct, cell layers in the ductal epithelium more than two. However, there's absence of any atypical cells.
ATP or proliferation is not there. So two things are, you have to know. Proliferation of cells, that is increased number and size, hyperplasia and hypertrophy, plus atypia. Cells become mad, atypia. Okay. Both things are considered when a pathologist looks into under the microscope. Proliferation and atypia. So here, neither proliferation nor atypia. Okay. Non-proliferative. Usual cyst. You read the term fibroadenosis, which is benign nodular disease. We don't call it fibroadenosis, we just say benign nodularity as part of ANDI, benign nodularity, with or without cyclical mastalgia, cyclical pronounced mastalgia with premenstrual exacerbation, usually with tender nodularity, present either diffusely or in upper outer quadrant, occurring the premenstrual phase. And then with the onset of menstrual flow, the nodularity and the pain tend to reduce or ease off. So books have been describing it as fibroadenosis. The Cardiff terminology doesn't like the term fibroadenosis, so we just call it benign nodularity. Okay, benign nodularity, some typical fibroadenomas as seen in young girls, typical cysts, simple cysts, usual ductal hyperplasia, as Dr. Tethaman just defined, more than 2 layer cells without proliferation and without atypia. Apocrine metaplasia. Apocrine, simple apocrine metaplasia. What is the meaning of apocrine? Word apocrine means what?
Related to the sweat glands. A gland which degenerates completely after releasing its secretions.
Complete degeneration is holocrine. Oh. An example is sebaceous gland. Sebaceous gland, which is not an independent gland, it is present inside the hair follicle. These cells undergo degeneration and the entire cell content is then thrown into the lumen. That is holocrine gland. Apocrine means the apical bud. The secretions collect in a vesicle near the apex of the cell towards the lumen. And then only that vesicle gets separated and rest of the cell remains. That is called apocrine. Apocrine means apex of the cell forms a vesicle and the whatever the secretions have to come out will come out through that vesicle. And the rest of the cell will stay there. So proliferation of such apocrine cells is called apocrine metaplasia. Initially, pathologists considered it to be high risk factor, but current understanding puts this apocrine metaplasia in the low risk category, 1.3 or less. Okay. Now, mind you, this is 1.3, it is not 1. So, any risk greater than 1 is a risk factor. Less than 1 is protective. So, 1.3 means that 30% increased chance of developing cancer. So, even these benign, that's why even these benign conditions carry some risk. So, it is not. You know, it's good to tell them, to reassure them that Mataji, mother, dear sister or mother, you do not have cancer. Do not worry. But then keep getting checked up. Tell them you do self-examination once a month. And if any abnormality, lump, nipple retraction, blood discharge is noticed, please come to us. And maybe get a mammogram over age 40 because there is some risk, 30% increase in risk. Okay. The second category is moderate risk. And here, relative risk is in the range of 1.8 to 2. It is also called proliferative because here cells have undergone hyperplasia and hypertrophy. There's proliferation of the epithelial cells, luminal and lobular cells. And in this category, we have got papilloma, sclerosing adenosis, radial scar, florid ductal hyperplasia, flat cell change, columnar cell change, etc. They are all rare conditions. But the papilloma is, in this group, papilloma is the commonest. We often see as a cause of blood-related discharge. Lady 40 plus age group comes with history of blood discharge, usually from single duct, but it could be multiple. And the commonest cause of blood discharge, lady, is papilloma. Papilloma. So this carries moderate risk. Type of proliferative lesion, risk is in the range of 2. 2 times increased risk than a lady on the street and a lady in the normal form. High risk, where risk is 4 times the normal, and here we have atypia. Here we have atypia, and if you take long term studies, then you find these persons who have atypia in the, they have 1% per year, 1% per year. So in 5 years, 5%, 10 years, 10%. If you take 100 ladies with atypia, on year 1 of the beginning of the study, you'll find 1 out of 100 will develop cancer. Next year, 2, 3, 4, 5. In 10 years, 10 ladies out of 100 will develop cancer. And if they all live for 100 years, how much will be their risk? 100%. If they live till 100 years. Currently, we have a lady admitted. She happens to be great grand nani ji of one of our doctors, and she is 102. She is still going strong. ADH. So in this category, we have atypical ductal hyperplasia and atypical lobular hyperplasia. ADH and ALH are put into this category. High risk, relative risk is 4, 1% per year is the risk. Then we have the last category of very high risk, 8 or more, 8 to 10 or more. And this category includes lobular carcinoma in situ. And here it is more than 1% per year cumulative risk. Usually in most studies, about 1.8 to 2% per year. Okay, we can simply remember this is relative 4, risk is 1% per year. This is 8, so 2 times the 4, that is 2% per year the risk. And lobular carcinoma in situ, or LCIS, will be included in this study. So lobular carcinoma in situ is a very interesting lesion, and recently they have changed its name. Just call it lobular neoplasia because they don't want to use the term carcinoma. It is not a cancer. Therefore, the AJCC 8th edition has removed it as type of cancer. It's a precursor. It is a harbinger of a cancer. So if you find this lesion in somebody's mammary gland, you know that this lady is 8 to 10 times greater chance of developing cancer in future. Okay. And average cumulative incidence is, a cumulative risk is 2% per year. ADH ALA was 1% per year, and here a relative risk was 4. Here relative risk is 8 to 10, and they have 2% per year. 2% per year of developing cancer. Okay. And interestingly, although it is globular, half of them will progress to ductal carcinoma. Another half will develop to lobular. Both ductal and lobular cancer can develop in a lady who has LCIS. In fact, we have a story. We treated a lady, served a lady, and she has been coming from 2002, I think, when she developed some suspicious lesion. And her sister actually had breast cancer, so she got it, alarm. So her mammogram showed a suspicious lesion. On biopsy, it was LCIS. We removed that area and kept her on follow-up. She probably at that time did not like the idea of having tamoxifen for 5 years. So almost 10 years later, she developed cancer in the opposite breast, very small tumor, treated by lumpectomy and radiotherapy and tamoxifen. 2 years later, she developed another cancer. Same breast. So we then when he told about the family history of sister, then we got her BRCA mutation done. She has BRCA1 gene mutation. So we offered her the option of bilateral risk-reducing mastectomy. She actually accepted, and we performed bilateral risk-reducing mastectomy on her. And lobular carcinoma, and this was ductal carcinoma. She had LCIS in one breast, but when she developed cancer on the other side, it was ductal. So half of these lobular lesions will progress to ductal carcinoma, other half to lobular. Very interesting observation. So in the exam, in the Viva or quiz, they may ask, you know, if cancer develops from DCIS, what will be type? Ductal carcinoma. If carcinoma develops in lobular carcinoma, what will be type? Everybody, you know, will make a common sense answer, reply. Lobular. Oh, only half will have lobular, half will have. Okay. Probably because the whole TDLU is disease. Whole TDLU is disease, and it may either develop cancer from the duct. Now, we have preventive drugs like tamoxifen, raloxifen, exemestane, and estradiol. Four drugs have been found to be effective. They all reduce the risk by about 50% in general. But in LCIS, and a typical hyperplasia, the risk reduction is to a greater extent, up to 70%. So in other ladies, risk reduction will be about 50% cancer, breast cancer reduction. But in very high risk carriers, such as ADH, ALH, and LCIS, risk reduction can happen to the tune of 70% reduction. Very profound reduction. So you must offer this option of anti-estrogen. SERM, selective estrogen receptor modulated drugs like tamoxifen, raloxifen, anastrozole, and exemestane. Exemestane and anastrozole are aromatase inhibitors, and tamoxifen and raloxifen are SERM, selective estrogen receptor modulated. Percent per year is. So we have classification: lobular carcinoma, very high risk, then proliferative without atypia. Columnar cell, radial scar, closing adenosis, papillary lesion, fibroid. These are a proliferative without. Some people put fibroadenoma into non-proliferative. There is some confusion. Proliferative with atypia, we have ADH and ALH, ADH ductal hyperplasia, ALH lobular hyperplasia, and LCIS is also put as a proliferative with atypia, highest risk. So these are the lesions which have a different risk, relative risk stated on this table. Flat cell epithelium 1.5, capillary lesion 2, radial scar 2, fibroadenoma 1.8, complex fibroadenoma 3, ADH or ALH 4, LCIS 8 to 10. Okay, and in these 1% per year, and here it is 1 to 2% per year. So how will we know about this? We'll know that lady has come, you find some nodule or lump, or she has a high family history. Based on that, you arrange a mammogram and sometimes MRI, and on that you find a lesion which should be biopsied. So you biopsy it, and the lesion shows ADH, ALH, LCIS. So what do we do? Next, we take the patient for surgery. Why we want to do surgery? One is excision is to rule out existence of overt malignancy. Part of the, when we take biopsy, suppose we take 100, there are 1 million cells or 100,000 cells, and you have taken 100 cells. You do not know what is happening in 990 cells. So it is a sampling error. So more biopsies you take, more closer you are to proteins. To take the whole lump out, you know that complete excision. So complete excision will tell you the truth whether there is a focus of invasive cancer, microinvasive cancer, or pure hyperplasia or dysplasia. So therefore, surgical excision of the suspicious lesion seen on imaging is important. And second important thing is there are certain lesions like LCIS, like ADH and ALH. Core biopsy will say ADH, but you take the hole out, will show cancer. Can somebody explain how this happens? Give the example of ADH and explain how biopsy shows ADH, but full excision shows ductal carcinoma in situ. Can somebody explain? You know the definition of two lesion, you can explain. Biopsy, needle biopsy, core needle biopsy, Rupert biopsy shows ADH. When we excise the whole lesion, it says ductal carcinoma in situ. Now explain.
The sample which was taken for core biopsy did not have two ducts, or it was less than 2 millimeter.
Very good.
I mean,
very
it is
good.
Not.
That means you are a thinking surgeon. So my teacher used to ask, my teacher in professor of surgery used to ask, you want to be a thinking surgeon or a cutting surgeon? Well, most of them, are just technicians. That's why physicians, they consider surgeons as a lower species of animals. This was perhaps the reason they were relegated to the task that barbers used to do. And the surgeons had to go to Royal College of Barbers. That's why they were called. The initial Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh was actually Royal College of Barbers to begin with. And if you go to even Indian villages, abscess happens. So they will take the person, a patient, to a barber, village barber, for him to lance the abscess by his razor, Ustara. The same Ustara, same razor, which he uses for shaving the head. So, but you are a thinking surgeon. I'm glad that you're thinking. So this is the thing. You take biopsy, you take only, say, one duct. And one duct shows some proliferation. More cells, more than two layers of cells. So you can only say it is hyperplasia. Unless I give you three or four ducts, you cannot tell me whether it is DCIS or ADH. ADH is defined as two, rule of two, two ducts less than 2 millimeter. Same picture involving more than two ducts, more than 2 millimeter will be called DCIS. So it is your duty as a surgeon to remove the lesion, suspicious Virat spore. That's why the rule is all Virat spore and five lesion must be excised. All Virat spore and five lesion must be excised to rule out this thing. This is called upgradation in pathology. So they say upgrading. Okay, lesion was described as benign, but when we excised it, the report got upgraded to diagnosis of carcinoma. So this is also a high risk lesion. Whether or not in future this lady will develop cancer, that is one thing. But one definition of high risk lesion is this: any lesion which is benign on biopsy, when removed, shows an upgradation of diagnosis to cancer. This is also a high risk lesion. You should know which lesions have a chance of high upgradation. And this literature says upgradation more than 5%, you should consider as high risk lesion. So ADH, ALH, papillomatosis, and LCIS, they are high grade lesion. They get increased upgraded to carcinoma. Because the diagnosis is depending on the volume of the tissue sample. If you excise the whole thing, you will know the truth. Overt malignancy can be missed on a core biopsy. This is a very important fact to appreciate. Overt frank cancer. DCIS is not frank cancer. LCIS is not frank cancer. But that part of it has become malignant or not can be missed if you take only a core biopsy. That's why they say if we see papillary lesion on high resolution ultrasound or mammogram MRI, they say just go for excision. Do not biopsy a papillary lesion. That's the rule. Do not biopsy a papillary lesion. If imaging suggests a papilloma, history of blood discharge suggests a papilloma, excise it. Excise it. And what do we excise in blood discharge from the nipple? With imaging suggestive of a papilloma in major mammary duct, what operation do we do? What do we excise?
If it's an intraductal papilloma, radical duct excision up to 5 centimeter depth.
Very good. Major memory duct excision or radical duct excision, as described in detail by Hatfield, is the treatment of choice in these patients. If a lady is young and she has not yet breastfed her children, wants to have family, then and the discharge is from single duct, you can offer microductomy, but again remove 5 cm duct from the nipple down to the depth. If multiple ducts are involved and or she has completed her family, she is 40 plus, you are worried about cancer, then remove all the major ducts, perform major memory duct excision, major memory duct. Okay. So it's a very interesting lesion called radial scar or sclerosing adenosis. So what is it? That there is a central fibroelastic stroma and radiating ducts. Radiating ducts arranged like a rosette, like a petals of a flower. So dilated ducts arranged like petals of a flower, a rosette, and a central fibroelastic core. This is called radial scar if it is less than 1 cm, and it is called sclerosing adenosis if it is more than 1 cm. Same lesion. Histology, x-ray, risk, everything is same. It's only the size. If it is less than 1 cm, the term is radial scar. And if it's more than 1 cm, the term is sclerosing adenosis. Okay. And how do you identify? On mammogram, there'll be architecture distortion and central lucency in the lesion. Central lucency and radiating spicules are seen on mammogram. It is excision. Excision recommended. First core biopsy will not. You can do vacuum assisted biopsy, where vacuum assisted instrument has a very wide tube needle, 8 to 9 mm in diameter. So that is recommended, but conventional core biopsy is not recommended. So this is the classical picture of a sclerosing adenosis or radial scar. See, the lesion is, so there's a discrete lesion, right? Increased radio density and spiculated. Can you appreciate these spiculated margins? Like crab, spiculated margins, spicules like thorn, okay, and the central area is radiolucent. So central lucency and radiating spicules. This picture is called radial scar. It is less than 1 cm and sclerosing adenosis if it is more than 1 cm cut off. Same lesion. Radial scar or sclerosing adenosis. Capillary lesions are proliferation of the ductal epithelium and they have a fibrovascular core, and this papilloma sometimes undergoes either its fibril and then undergoes necrosis, sloughing, then there will be bleeding. Or if the papilloma undergoes torsion, like torsion of the testis, then also you can have, after torsion, the papilloma will slough and it will be shed off, and from the broken stalk, there will be bleeding. So this results in blood discharge, spontaneous blood discharge from single or multiple ducts. Central papilloma near the major ducts, near the nipple, are solitary and they do not carry a significant higher risk. They are in the category of proliferative without atypia. Relative risk is about 1.8 to 2. Okay. And then there is a peripheral variety which is located near the terminal ducts. And they can be multiple. And our students remember is as this. Plural. Peripheral, plural. Plural means multiple. Predilection, increased predilection for multicentricity, for bilaterality, or risk of developing cancer and recurrence. Predilection for peripheral. So papillomatosis, peripheral. Plural means more than one. Predilection for multiple lesions. Predilection for bilaterality. predilection for cancer conversion and predilection for recurrence. Okay? And risk of malignancy is higher in multiple papillomas. Relative risk, if ATPI is present, goes to 4 to 5. Yes, single papilloma may be 1.8 or 2. And if you have papillomatosis with ATPI, then relative risk is high up to 7. So it keeps on increasing with or without ATPI. This is a classical presentation of a patient coming with either ADH or ALH. ALH can also lead to death, mostly ADH or DCIS. The difference is only in the ducts. Less than 2 mm or 2 millimeter, 2 ducts. ADH more than two ducts or 2 mm is DCIS or papilloma. Okay, so if you find something suspicious, then you have to identify it and biopsy it, either by simple biopsy, image guided, or by serotype. Now, some other lesions are described in the literature, like flat epithelium, ATPI, columnar cell change, and they are all examples of proliferation disease, usually without ATPI. So, risk will be 1.8 to 2, not very high. But if it is associated with typical ductal hyperplasia, then risk will be 4. If it is DCIS, again risk is, DCIS is now considered cancer, DIS in situ cancer. Okay. All these changes, flat epithelial ATPI, etc., ought to be precursor for low grade DCIS. Treatment is surgical excision, and if it is found, margin revision is not needed. So this is another interesting thing. Oh, you have a benign lesion on biopsy, fibroepithelial lesion, flat cell change, columnar cell change, LCIS. Complete excision with negative margin is not needed, because you're not dealing with cancer. You are only taking the biopsy or excising it to know whether there is a focus of cancer, so upgrading the diagnosis, or if it is not cancer, how much is ATPI or proliferation. That's why you are excited. So margin, negative margin is not needed. Okay. Atypical ductal hyperplasia, ADH, is an epithelial proliferation, and there'll be ATPI also on the architecture distortion. Will be similar to DCIS. Again, you remember the rule, less than 2 ducts, less than 2 mm will be called ADH. More than 2 mm or 2 ducts will be called DCIS. So, and in this, upgrade rate is 20%. ADH, if you get core biopsy showing ADH, what is your duty? Madam, you have some high risk lesion. It has a chance of upgrading. Upgrading means, if I remove this whole lesion, 20 out of 100 such lesions will actually show a focus of cancer. So it gets upgraded. Please remove it. And madam, I do not know, based on mammogram and other family history, I do not know whether you belong to this 20% or 80%. So it is better to assume you are in 20% and let me remove your lump totally. Okay. And if it shows cancer, well, you congratulate you and yourself and your patient that you got a very small micro lesion or just microinvasive lesion, and you have cured her. So this is the advantage of screening, that screening can detect early cancer and which can. There is a study in the literature by this name, Vanderbilt study, has shown that history of breast cancer in first degree relative increases the chance of other patients in the family. Relative risk is 9. Family history, first degree relative, relative risk 9. Very high. So very high. 8 to 10 was considered very high. This is very high. Memory is free. Surgical excision is recommended for all this ADH. Okay. And less than 6 mm lesion and less than 3/4 of ADH can be observed. But larger lesion, palpable lesion, could be investigated or better still fully removed. And then you can offer chemo prevention. Because of these patients carry how much risk? 4 to 5 times risk of developing cancer in future. And therefore, you offer them some either chemo prevention or risk reducing surgery. So the term, current term is globular neoplasm. LCIS has been removed from the current nomenclature because it gives a wrong impression that a patient has cancer and everybody gets alarmed. Oh, my mother or sister has cancer. So they just say, they just call it neoplasm, globular neoplasia. And globular neoplasia was the coin used by Higginson. And initially he included all. But in those days, this classification of more than 2 depths, etc., was not there. Okay. Okay. Similar to the ADH and DCIS classification here, we are saying that for LCIS, involved liver should have globular neoplastic cells which are filling and distant 50% of the SNI. And if it is less than, if it is filling less than 50% of SNR units, then we say ALH. More than 50% of SNI units are filled, we say LCIS. Okay. LCIS, more than 50% of units filled, less than 50% will be called ALH. So you check a lobule. Okay, you check a lobule, and if you find that in a lobule, half or less than half are filled with these proliferative cells, use the term ALH. More than half are filled in a lobule, more than half of these cells are proliferative, you call it LCIS, 50%. See? 50% of SNR units, LCIS. Less than 50%, ALH. So, like that rule of 2 is for ADH and DCIS. For LCI, for lobular lesion, rule is 50%. Okay? 50%, actually, you can say 2, more than 2 times. I think it's converted. Right. So there is a category of lobular in situ lesion called pleomorphic, which has a sort of necrosis. Like you remember comedo necrosis in DCIS, similar cheesy material in the lumen. Clearly, we have a pleomorphic LCIS, which is a central necrosis. It has high grade cytology. So this is considered a highly proliferative lesion and is better excised completely. But otherwise, LCIS need not be removed completely. What is the management of lobular lesion? It's important to distinguish between LCIS and ALH. But core biopsy is not satisfactory. You have to excise the lesion. Then only you will know the difference. That means it a risk of upgrading. And there's a study there found that upgradation rate in lobular lesion was 25% for LCIS and 22% for ALH on core biopsy. We did a core biopsy and they said 20 ALH. You know from this previous data by this gentleman, Brahm et al., that 22%, 22 out of 100 such ladies where ALH will be reported actually will have cancer. The diagnosis will be upgraded. And if it is LCIS reported, upgradation rate will be 25%. Therefore, excision is recommended for a patient where core biopsy shows lobular neoplasia. So, if you have excised a lump, say fibroadenoma, and there is a small focus of lobular lesion, it's called incidental lobular neoplasia, and you can just, a small microscopic lesion can be just observed, but otherwise you offer excision and some other factor. And you can observe these patients if it's incidental finding or no residual lesion after the core biopsy. You have completely excised. Okay. And it is, if it is not pleomorphic LCIS, you can observe. But the pleomorphic type is more aggressive. So women with LCIS have a 1 to 2% risk of developing cancer. It can be lobular or ductal, either ipsilateral or bilateral, contralateral also. Remember the rule of 10 in lobular? 10% of all lesion, all cancers, lobular, 10% bilateral, 10% multicentric. Just this is that lobular lesion we are talking about. It can be ipsilateral or bilateral. Multicentric and bilaterality are common. Drugs like tamoxifen, raloxifen, anastrozole, exemestane all have been shown to reduce the risk by 50%, 50 to 56% in lobular lesions. Okay, and these patients should be lobular lesion should be put on long-term surveillance because relative risk is 10, 8 to 10. Okay, and yearly risk, cumulative risk is 2% per year. In ADH, it is 1% per year. In lobular lesion, it is 2% per year. That's like, huh? So in lobular lesion, relative risk is 8 to 10 and cumulative risk is 2% per year. Okay. And half progress to ductal, half place to lobular. And this cancer, same breast or the opposite, same or opposite. And tamoxifen, raloxifen, exemestane, and so they all work on this. And they will reduce the risk about 50%. But if there is LCIS, it can reduce up to 70%. Remember the concept of upgrading the lesion, that is you remove the lesion and benign biopsy diagnosis gets upgraded to cancer. And this is very common with LCIS, ADH and ALA. Okay. Then that ADH, ALA, no surgical excision, and for very small lesion you can observe. And the distinction between LCIS and AD, ALH, 50-50. If they fill 50%, so if less than 50% of the SNI are filled, we will call it, less than 50% lobules are filled by proliferative cells, ALH. More than 50% or all 50% are LCIS. Upgradation is how much? 25 to 30%. LCIS. And what is the relative risk of cancer? 8 to 10. What's the cumulative risk per year? 2% per year. 2% per year. Very high. Highest risk. 2% per year. And pleomorphic LCIS is the worst. So pleomorphic lesion must be excised in completely with negative margin. Otherwise, in LCIS, we say that just one excision mission, positivity of the margin should not bother because it is not a cancer, it is only a precursor or harbinger of cancer. Harbinger, you know, the
cuckoo is the harbinger of spring. Like that you say, no?
Or simple flu may be the harbinger of Frank Corona.
Yes, sir.
And okay. Harbinger means the messenger, messenger. Some
input.
जो आता है ना जैसे अंगद अंगद आई थिंक अंगद वेंट टू ना रावण्स दरबार ना लेके जो
हाँ सर
वो टेक्स द इनफॉरमेशन टू राजा सो प्लियोमॉर्फिक द एलसीआई इज अ हार्बिंजर ऑफ कैंसर सो फोर ड्रग्स हैव बीन अप्रूव्ड for chemo prevention of these high-risk lesions, tamoxifen, raloxifene. They are two SERM selective estrogen receptor modulator drugs. How do they work? They block the cytosolic and nuclear estrogen receptor protein. There is a receptor on the cell surface and cytoplasm on which estrogen molecule works. Tamoxifen and raloxifene block even centromere. They block that receptor and they do not allow the estrogen to trigger these changes on the surface on the cytosolic estrogen molecule, which then triggers set of reactions which bring this complex, the estrogen and estrogen receptor complex, then goes to travels to the nucleus. In nucleus, there is a nuclear ER, nuclear estrogen receptor protein, and in the nucleus, it will trigger mitosis. Okay, this is how we call that estrogen is a mitogen. Mitogen, it causes mitosis, is a growth factor. So tamoxifen and raloxifene are blocking that, okay? Now there are other two drugs which are not SERM. They are, what are they called? Aromatase inhibitor. So, who will tell me where aromatase enzyme works? Aromatase.
Peripheral adipose.
So, start from cholesterol. Cholesterol is the precursor of all these steroid hormones. Cholesterol to 7-dehydrocholesterol, 7-dehydrocholesterol to pregnenolone, pregnenolone to progesterone, progesterone to endosterine dione to estrogen. This last step, estrogen to estradiol beta is under the influence of aromatase enzyme. Okay, there is a pathway where endosterone dione is converted to estrogen.
Estrogen is converted to estrone. Testosterone to estrogen, and estrogen can be interchangeable.
Estrone is then converted to 17-beta-estradiol. Okay, so that is also another pathway of estrogen formation. So aromatase enzyme will block this path conversion of testosterone to 17-beta-estradiol. Okay, it's working at two levels, and exemestane and estrazole, they are both have been shown to achieve chemo prevention by blocking the aromatase enzyme. Okay, so indication for these drugs: presence of high-risk lesion or high-risk patient with a strong family history of breast cancer, a personal history of breast carcinoma in one breast. You know, a history of breast cancer in one breast is the highest risk factor. It's the highest. She is living with all the risk, genetic, hormonal, molecular pathway. All the risk factors are present in the breast. Not only the same breast, but also in the opposite breast. So history of cancer in one breast is the highest risk factor for opposite breast. History of DVT is the highest risk factor for DVT. History of melanoma is highest risk factor for melanoma. So, you know, because whatever gene or abnormal molecular biology you have, you are living with that. So then Gale model is there. You assess the risk 1.6 or more. And then BRCA mutation is another factor that they are less many syndrome. Tamoxifen is a selective estrogen receptor modulator, and there was a famous NSABP P1 trial, which was a large prevention trial where 13,000 ladies were recruited in this study, and for prevention of breast cancer among high risk carriers, and they found that about 43 to 50%, nearly half of the ER positive tumors were prevented. Okay, there was no prevention of the ER negative tumors, but 50% of the ER positive tumors only prevents estrogen receptor positive tumors. But its use comes with a price. Price is an increased risk of uterine cancer. Uterine cancer is thromboembolic phenomena leading to a stroke or heart attack, thrombosis of the arteries and veins, and increased risk of cataract. And based on this trial, FDA has now approved, and many countries, you know, they approved tamoxifen for 20 mg daily for 5 years as chemo prevention among high risk. So, raloxifen was part of the NSBP P2, P for prevention, P2 trial, STAR trial, tamoxifen and raloxifen were used again the same. And both were drugs were equally effective. That means both reduce the risk of breast cancer to 50%, but the cost is different. You know, raloxifen is more expensive. Isimestane aromatase inhibitor, it will work only in postmenopausal women. No aromatase inhibitor will work in the premenopausal ladies when ovaries are secreting significant amount of estrogen. Aromatase inhibitor do not block the estrogen release from the ovaries. They only work in the peripheral conversion of testosterone to estradiol 17 beta, which occurs in 4 sites. What are the 4 sites where this aromatase enzyme is present? LAMB.
Liver, adrenal, muscle, and bone.
Liver, adipose tissue, muscle, skeletal muscle, and bones. Liver, LAMB, lamb, you know, baby sheep, LAMB, lamb. Liver, adipose tissue, muscle, skeletal muscles, and bones. And that's why bones become weak. When you block this enzyme, bones become weak. They are prone to fractures, osteopenia, osteoporosis, fractures, and bony aches and pains, arthralgia, and muscle pains, muscle weakness. These are common symptoms because of the blockage of the enzyme. Okay? Increased risk of fractures involved. But again, they offer significant reduction. So, indication for surgery, lobular carcinoma, and this is. So, this is typical. What is this lesion showing? Speculated.
With a central umbilication.
Radial
scar.
Localized lesion with speculated margins and a central UNC. What is the diagnosis?
If it's less than 1 centimeter, then it's radial scar. If it is more than 1 centimeter, it's sclerosing adenosis.
Very good. And the relative risk for conversion? 1.8 to 2. Lifetime risk or 1% per year. 1%. So core biopsy, you do excise, and on taking out the lesion, you must cut it and see if there is homogeneous tissue or there are cleft-like spaces and Coca-Cola brown fluid, in which case the diagnosis may be myeloids. Okay. And in this lesion, one excision, we found that core biopsy was very interesting, adenomyoepithelioma. Previous mammogram diagnosis was radial scar, but when we removed it, this was the actual. Again, very rare. Papilloma is quite common, and this is what we do. We perform 5 centimeter ductal cone excision, radical duct excision, and during dissection, we found a papilloma peeping out from a duct. You can see this. It popped out of the duct, and so you should carefully dissect it out and remove it. At least 5 centimeter of the major ducts from the nipple. Okay. If you have suspicious lesion, this lady's mother had breast cancer, so she was getting yearly mammogram at age of 44. They noticed something suspicious on mammogram, so she went to have stereotactic biopsy and then excision of this. I think I'll stop here and then take questions. Yes, please.
But if a non-proliferative lesion on core biopsy, if that is that comes out to be a proliferative lesion on the final biopsy, then also we will call it an upgradation.
Upgradation means you get final biopsy shows cancer.
अच्छा कैंसर हैज टू बी देयर
कैन बी इन डीसीआई यस
ओके
कैंसर प्रीवियस रिपोर्ट वाज एडीएच एंड फाइनल रिपोर्ट इज कैंसर बिकॉज यू गॉट ऑल द डक्ट्स सो यू काउंट मोर देन टू डक्ट्स मोर देन 2 मिलियन दैट्स अपग्रेडेशन बट इफ द फाइनल रिपोर्ट आल्सो सेज एडीएच लेस देन 2 मिलीमीटर सो दैट इज नॉट अपग्रेडेशन अपग्रेडेशन मींस अपग्रेडेड इन द armament not armament in the hierarchy of lesions progression you get upgraded to higher stage from usual metaplasia you get reported ADH
suppose in the pre-op setting the core biopsy showed it's a fibroadenoma and finally when we excise the lump it comes out to be atypical ductal hyperplasia then shall we call it an upgradation
No, upgradation term has been used in only relation to cancer.
Okay, sir.
Final report is cancer.
Sir, in case of family history, if the female came saying that her father had breast cancer, then is that a risk factor?
Yes.
Very much so. In fact, all male cancer patients should get their BRCA gene mutation then. Because male breast cancer is very rare. And if it is present, you must rule out BRCA gene mutation, BRCA 1 or BRCA 2. So, that is a rule actually for genetic testing. The rule is that if you have male breast cancer, triple negative below 50, male breast cancer is an indication for doing genetic. So, genetic testing and then surgery for that patient surgery and sentinel node if node is negative or X-ray dissection and then post-op less than 2 cm tumor in the breast with node negative. Usually they don't give any chemotherapy in male breast cancer, just tamoxifen for 5 years. For node negative, probably they may give tamoxifen for 10 years. Chemotherapy is not given for node negative tumor in the male breast less than 2 cm. Any other question? Otherwise we can then.
Modifiable risk factors. HRT sir is a known risk factor, but OC pills sir, should we consider OC pills as a risk factor?
No. Current generation of contraceptives, we have become wiser. So gynecologists don't give high estrogen pills or high estrogen combination pills. They use low dose levonorgestrel. No. So current generation low dose estrogen is not a risk factor. And if you are using Senproman like contraceptive, that is certainly protective if anything. Current generation OCP doesn't cause cancer.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. Okay. So I will send some important classic papers. By Hartman and DeFont and Page by email, and then you can all share it and enjoy it. Okay. And then decide about the next topic and then let me know. Let Dr.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Yajuta, yes. You translated the self-examination into Gujarati?
No, sir, Marathi.
Marathi. So we need you to just give your voice. On a good quality recording, maybe a good quality phone, you know, okay. Voicemail, and then send it by either email or WhatsApp. And our doctor who is making these modules, her name is Dr. Akansha Jain. So she will be in touch with you, Dr. Akansha Jain, okay?
Okay.
And then they will ask some more questions, you know, translate into Hindi text also, Hindi or English. Okay, thank you very much. So, I will share your number to Dr. Akansha, who is making these test modules. Thank you very much. So think about the next topic and then let me know. Thank you very much. God bless you for your exams.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.